Hi, I'm STS-131 Mission Specialist Stephanie Wilson, and you are watching NASA TV.
Good morning, Discovery, and a special good morning to Stephanie.
Good morning, Houston. I'd like to thank my parents, Barbara and Eugene, for selecting that song. It certainly is a wonderful world, especially from this vantage point. We've had a wonderful time at the International Space Station and enjoyed our time with the crew. We're looking forward to packing up today and coming home to see our family and friends tomorrow. It's been a great mission and a wonderful journey. And Houston, thanks so much for your support, and we look forward to working with you today.
Discovery, Houston for message 149 and the weather picture.
We're looking at it. Go ahead.
Okay, great. Dex, I'm just going to go over it page by page. Like I said, it's not really bad. There's just a few minor deltas that we want to get up to you so you'll have the complete picture.
Ready to copy.
Okay, starting with that first chart that shows the United States. The updated weather package shows that weak front has moved a little further south over the southeastern United States, and it's now basically going to be sitting over North Florida. And there's also a low that you don't have that's kind of down over Cuba that's also going to be affecting your weather. Flipping to the next page, your KSC forecast for tomorrow on your landing day, flight day 15, is going to be scattered at 3,000. Broken at 8,000, overcast at 25,000, but there's going to be showers forecast within 30 miles. Also, the winds looking at 030, 9 peak 13, which gives you an 11 knot crosswind. There's no plan to call up Edwards for tomorrow for the landing day, but the weather is pretty much the same, 10,000 scattered, broken 25,000, so it looks pretty good. For Northrop, the lake beds are currently red, Dex, and the reason is there's standing water. And then for tomorrow afternoon, they're forecast 50% chance of thunderstorms, so it's likely they could even get some more water. So we won't say too much more about Northrop. Flight's going to be monitoring the situation, but we don't expect to call them up.
Hey, CJ, that's great. So forecast for Monday, it sounds like you went from 10,000 broken down to 8,000 broken, and the chance of showers within 30 went to a solid showers within 30. Is that correct?
That's a good copy, Dex. Discovery, Houston, are you ready for the event?
Houston, we're ready for the event.
WBZ AM radio, this is Houston. Please call Discovery for a voice check.
Discovery, this is WBZ. How do you hear me?
Good morning. Welcome aboard the Shuttle Discovery. We have you loud and clear.
Wonderful. Commander Poindexter, my first question is for you. Discovery, obviously, due to land in Florida tomorrow, and with all of the air travel problems involving volcanic ash from Iceland, the Discovery is one of the few flying aircraft, it seems. Let me first ask, do you have any sense of this volcanic ash cloud and or erupting volcano where you are several hundred miles up?
That's a great question, Mary. We've been looking for it, and we haven't seen the volcanic ash plume yet. We hope to soon and perhaps today and maybe take a few photographs of it.
Also, Commander Poindexter, this is one of the last shuttle missions. Outline the goals and accomplishments on this mission, which obviously involved the International Space Station.
Mary, our primary mission was a resupply and return supply mission to the International Space Station. We also did three spacewalks to replace an ammonia tank, which is used in the space station's thermal cooling system. And we did three of those spacewalks, and we moved about 13 tons of supplies. We had a great time during our docked phase of our mission, and we're really looking forward to coming home to Florida.
Rick, this question is for you. I know you did the actual spacewalking. How do you prepare for that?
Well, we prepare for spacewalks in a large swimming pool down at the Johnson Space Center. This pool is about 200 feet long and 40 feet deep, and we have mock-ups of the space shuttle and the space station in the swimming pool. And we go in there, we call it a neutral buoyancy lab. We go in there in our spacesuits, and we translate around and turn the bolts, and just like we're going to do in the real environment of space.
Stephanie, this question is for you. I know that you have local connections, as does Rick. You snapped some pictures of home. Describe your feelings as you're looking at Earth from your vantage point.
It is definitely a unique perspective and something that is awe-inspiring. Looking back at Earth is something that we never tire of. And especially this morning, we did an East Coast pass. Although it was night, we flew up the East Coast. So Rick and I were able to look at our hometowns, and it's very awesome, but also makes us miss our family and friends.
Also, you have made new friends, Stephanie, aboard the International Space Station. Describe the emotions when you say hello and goodbye.
It's definitely very exciting. When we first arrive at the space station, we're happy to begin the work of the mission and to greet our International Space Station crew members. They were great hosts for us. We were able to get all of the work done, and it's sad to see them go, but we know that they have continuing work on the space station, so we bid them farewell, and we know that we'll see them soon at home.
And Commander Poindexter, my final question. Last week, President Obama predicted that his new space station exploration plans will be leading American astronauts to Mars. Your vision of the next step in space.
It's a real good question, and obviously one at a fairly high level. We'd all like to see America and the rest of the world's nations continue to do space exploration and visit Mars someday. Right now it takes a long time to get to Mars, so we're hoping to develop propulsion technology that will allow that trip to be much shorter.
Goodbye. Thank you so much for your time. A safe trip home.
Thanks, Mary. Good morning.
Discovery, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the WBZ portion of the event. Thanks. Please stand by for a voice check from the Associated Press.
Discovery, this is the Associated Press. How do you hear me?
Good morning, Marcia. We have you loud and clear. Welcome aboard Discovery.
Well, good morning to all of you here from your landing center. And my first question is for you, Commander Poindexter. It sounds like it might be a rainy morning tomorrow here. After a two-week mission, would you just as soon be able to land as soon as you can, or would you welcome an extra day in orbit?
Marcia, it's always a great time to spend on orbit. And we're confident that the folks in Houston and the folks in Florida will do everything they can to get us home when the weather will allow it.
Another question for you. Your crew encountered some snags like stiff bolts during the flight, yet you managed to overcome most of the trouble. How tough was the mission now that most of it's over, and how tiring was it for you and your crew?
Well, Marcia, as you know, shuttle missions are always a bit like a sprint as compared to a long-duration flight on the International Space Station, which is more of a marathon. And we expect to always hit some unexpected difficulties, like we did on our flight with the ammonia tank bolts. But the crew is really well trained, and we have outstanding engineering and operational support on the ground. And we have, obviously, a lot of contingency plans that allow us to prepare for those things. So when they do come up, we're ready for them, and we have enough margin in our schedule. So while it's busy and can be difficult at times, our schedule is built so that we can overcome any obstacles or snags that we hit.
For you, Colonel Dutton, obviously only three more shuttle flights left, and I'm wondering if that went through your mind at all during the mission, perhaps as you finished flying around the space station yesterday?
Well, I think for all of us, we're aware that this is probably our last flight aboard a space shuttle, and definitely as we were backing away from the space station yesterday, there were a lot of oohs and ahs on the flight deck. It was just absolutely beautiful to see that man-made creation up there floating above the Earth, and it really is, with all the shiny metal and the beautiful solar rays, it is a gorgeous vehicle to behold. And, you know, we, I think, just think that it's been a fantastic program. The shuttle has made a huge contribution to space exploration.
Clay Anderson, one for you. As a former space station resident, was it hard to leave the space station? And what struck you as the most significant change to the station since your last visit, besides obviously the size?
Well, the space station was really huge, and you know, having six people on board was also different for me because we were a smaller group of three crew members back then, and it was still hard to leave, but this time I had gotten my mindset into the short two-week shuttle mindset versus the marathon that Dex mentioned before. So that's kind of the process. You have to train your brain to figure out which one you're doing. You know, if you're going for long duration, you have to think that way, and if you go for short, you think that way as well. So it was tough both times.
For the commander again, how well have you kept abreast of the news about the new direction for NASA? I'm wondering, maybe did Mission Control send you up a copy of the president's speech or just news clips, or did you even go on the space station internet to find out more?
Hi, Marsha. We did get we do get news from home clips, and we did hear about the president's talk, and we're very excited about the future direction in human exploration of space.
For Dorothy Metcalf-Lindenberger, you're the youngest on the crew and one of the youngest in the astronaut corps, so let me ask you what you think of the new plan to fly to an asteroid by 2025, Mars by 2035. Do you see yourself being involved in any of that?
Well, that's an interesting question. We're just obviously getting to hear the news about the asteroid, and for just, I mean, the opportunity to fly on the shuttle was incredible for me, because when we were hired, we weren't even sure that our class would be able to fly on the shuttle. And so I'll have some patience, and I would really like to return to the International Space Station. And there's new folks in our office, too, that I know are very talented, and maybe they'll be the ones that lead us onto an asteroid. But it's cool to think that we're back in the exploration business. We've talked about how Lewis and Clark explored the Northwest, and maybe perhaps people thought they failed when they didn't find the Northwest Passage. But I would say that all of the things that came after Lewis and Clark are definitely not a failure, and I think that NASA will be involved in the same way, that we'll go out and explore, and we will find out so much more about our solar system.
Well, let me follow that up. You're also a teacher, and so do you think that shooting for an asteroid will excite school children perhaps more than heading back to the moon? Do asteroids and Mars have that extra zip that you think children will relate to?
You know, I came from a generation that didn't even get to see the lunar landings, and I was excited about going, as you say, maybe back to the moon just for the potential that we had there. But an asteroid is quite a challenge if you look at it from a standpoint of likelihood of interference with the Earth. You know, the Earth has been hit by large meteorites in the past that have caused severe destruction and extinction. And so perhaps that is a good reason to go to an asteroid also. But either way, wherever we go out in our solar system, from a teaching standpoint, I really hope that students are engaged in learning math and science and taking as much advantage of the technology we have. We should always try to be a leader in this.
Well, thank you very much, all of you. Have a safe journey back, and Godspeed.
Thanks, Marcia. Good morning.
Discovery, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the Associated Press portion of the event. Please stand by for a voice check from KEZI-TV.
KEZI-TV, how do you hear me?
Good morning, Brandy. We have you loud and clear. We're ready for your questions.
Terrific. Thank you so much. Most of my questions are going to be directed toward Colonel Rutten, because I'm based out of Eugene. But the first question I want to ask you, Jim, you've waited nearly 40 years for this experience. Was it worth all that you had to go through to get where you are right now?
Oh, it was absolutely worth it, and it was one of those things that in life that you hope to do and you have high expectations for, and the expectations were exceeded. It's been an unbelievable trip. Everything from viewing the Earth from the space station's cupola module down in the bottom where you can have a panoramic view to floating around to the launch, it's all just been incredible.
Now, Jim, we spoke a couple weeks before launch, and you said you're most looking forward to seeing that orbital sunrise. What was that like for you?
Well, our first sunrise was actually as we were climbing up into space. We were passing about Mach 7, and all of a sudden the horizon began to turn just a brilliant blue and yellow and red, and during our roll from top of the vehicle being down towards the ocean to having it up towards space, the horizon spun through the front window, and it's just absolutely gorgeous. The sun's very bright from space, I found out. Got blinded as soon as it actually cleared the horizon. It was amazing. And every sunrise and sunset I've seen since then have just taken my breath away.
Now, Jim, last time we spoke, you were also a little anxious about living in zero-G for 2 weeks. You said you'd heard the first time you push off once you release yourself and you're shooting for a certain position, you always end up too high because you're overcompensating for gravity. So I was curious, did you end up, what was that experience like?
Well, I tried to take it slow most of the times, and usually when I was trying to get somewhere fast, I didn't quite make it in the right direction and bounced off something, kicked something loose. There's a lot of that. The station crew members tend to be better flyers than we are because they've been up there a while, but it was a lot of fun, and definitely there's a learning curve to flying.
So, Jim, what do you think is going to be the favorite memory that you take back with you from the space station?
Well, there's too many really to pin one down, Brandy, but I think one of the high points that people back home will relate to would be when we had a daytime pass over the Pacific Northwest and we came right over Portland. We were looking down on Mount St. Helens. We saw Rainier. We saw Hood. We continued to the east. We could look back and see Crater Lake and the Cascades. It was just absolutely amazing because they were all so close together from up here, and yet you can still see a lot of detail with the human eye is just incredible in its ability to pick out detail from 200 miles away, and the colors and contours of the land. So that'll be a memory I'll certainly keep filed away for a long time.
Is it bittersweet at all knowing that the experience is almost over for you?
Yes, definitely. I think almost every one of the last few days I've turned to my crewmates and said, I'm getting sad, it's almost over. I know I'm very excited to get back and see my family, my wife and our four boys and our friends. But it has been an incredible experience, and so I'm trying to make every last minute of it count.
Something like 500 people traveled to Cape Canaveral to watch your launch. How does it feel to have that kind of support, from your family?
It was amazing, and it was also really hard because I was just a few miles away from them, and I didn't get to see any of them. But, they had a great time, from what I understand. There was a big gathering after the launch, and it's very very touching to know so many people were willing to come out. I felt very honored, and so did my wife, Erin.
Jim, thank you so much, and to the rest of the Shuttle Discovery crew, I hope you have a great and safe trip home.
Thank you, Brandy.
Discovery, this is Houston ACR. Thank you. That concludes the event.